and welcome to The Vote. I'm George Taylor, your host, and I'm joined by Johnbosco, a political expert. So we're going to go through all the political stories locally, nationally, and internationally. And the biggest one, of course, is Syria.
Syria.
How did you feel waking up on Saturday morning, seeing that we worked with the French and the Americans to bomb Syria?
Well, I felt sad, and I thought it was not a very good decision to bomb Syria. Firstly, because nobody should ever trust Trump as a sensible partner with whom to bomb anybody. Just last week, there was a report by The Hill. The Hill is a publication in the US that focuses on Congress, just like, well, not an exact replicate, but similar to Hansard here in the UK. And it reported, this was a headline, a real headline, it's not fake news. It said, Trump asked CIA officials why drone strike didn't kill target's family. So he was squeamish about a target who was killed but had not been killed along with his family. This is a man that Theresa May just essentially handed over the United Kingdom's military capabilities to bomb Syria. We know we've been told that it was targeted, it was a one-time thing, it was limited and specific and all sorts of, in my view, unverified statements. Yes, but we also know that those things have been said about strikes in the past, strikes in Syria specifically, all of which we have come to discover actually did kill civilians. So why do we believe it now?
I think the thing with Trump is a tweet resurfaced, and that was of 2013, where he said it was that we should not bomb Syria, which is just quite funny to laugh at now after he's been one of the people most pushed for it.
Yes.
I personally think the way doing the strikes is okay, because the places where we heard it hit was the chemical factories, and we told the Russians before so they can get out, so we didn't start World War III. But the fact that Theresa May didn't go through Parliament, she had enough time to call for to bring back MPs to make it an actual vote.
Yes.
But she didn't. And the fact she didn't do that, I mean, it's not law that she has to, but it's been convention since 2003, since Iraq. And it just feels wrong. That's what annoys me the most. It just feels like she bypassed Parliament. We go from a democracy to a dictatorship.
Yeah, so there is so much wrong with saying that that the Russians were informed about this strike before it was carried out. First of all, I haven't actually seen the report that the Russians were informed. I've seen a report that stated that the Russians were not informed. But assuming they were informed, what was the aim of this strike to begin with? The aim of this strike was, of course, supposed to be to deter any further use of chemical weapons by the Syrian government. Now, if you inform the Russians, chances are the Russians did inform the Syrians. And the Syrians would have moved most of their valuable assets away from those installments into Russian military areas, right, which the US and the UK had said they would not target. If the aim was to deter any further use of chemical weapons, how does prosecuting such a strike that informs the Russians satisfy that aim? So that is just something that is iffy about this all. But assuming they did not even inform them, it is quite interesting that they expect us to believe that there is a Syrian chemical weapons installment that had just been bombarded, which did not have a fallout, that the chemical weapons that had just been blown up did not spill out into the air, something to that effect. Of course, I don't really know very much about the technology behind this, so it's quite possible that there is some information in there that allows for the possibility that this could happen. But I would expect to be explained to how this could happen. But of course, I suppose we could go right back to the beginning and ask ourselves, was this strike the right thing? Do you believe it was the right thing?
I believe the principles, and if it was carried out properly, so what, and to a pinpoint perfect, then I believe it was the right
thing. So what are the principles that would justify this strike?
Should have been going through our parliament, and it should have gone through the US parliament, should have gone through the French parliament, as they are all democracies, and all the versions of the MPs.
Why does it have to be the US, the UK, and France? Why not the entire international community? Are these three countries the international community?
Well, international community-wise, they've had support from Canada, they've had support from Australia, yes, New Zealand.
Yes.
So it is getting
Are those country-wide. The international community? The international community is the United Nations.
United Nations, well, anything we do in the P5 is going to get vetoed by Russia anyway. They tried to do... tax on Syria, but Russia would keep on vetoing because they have good
So
friends.
Is that a reason to bypass the international community? Isn't that a reason to find ways to find a solution for this problem that Russia could support?
Well, no, we want to. I think that's a simple fact. No one wants to drop bombs, especially in the country where we are at the moment. We're paying a lot of money to BRICS and we're paying a lot of money to different things and we're going to have to borrow more money. We don't want to waste money on things that we don't think work. And I think sanctions might have worked. In the long run, they would have. But in the short term, where we need to save basically, Syrian lives who are getting gassed by their own leader, there needs to be a way of doing it. We need to do quick impact. And I think that was a smart decision.
Of course, as we have already discussed, I don't think that doing such a strike as the one that was done necessarily offers what you say, that quick impact. But secondly, what is the evidence that Assad did it?
I think it's more... Well, no, I would have seen... Because there was more searches that was meant to be taking place. So
yes,
they're supposed to be taking place...
By the OPCW, yes.
Yeah, and that's what we wanted to see. So I think going into it was too hasty.
But this strike did not wait for that search to happen.
Oh, no.
That investigation
I'm not supporting these strikes because they were not done in the correct manner.
Yes.
They were not done in the proper way we should do it in England. It's not done to our specifications.
Yes.
But the fact that she did it, I agree with, but I would have personally wanted to see more tests. I would have seen the actual going around, the actual people of the organisation coming in to look and make sure.
Now, that's the contradiction with what you're saying, right? You're saying that first of all, we should have allowed the Organisation for the Prevention of Chemical Weapons to have gone into Syria. We know that they are in Syria. They were in Syria the night before the attack itself. That we know that they're in Syria and they're supposed to have carried out investigations. Number one, to ascertain who carried out the attacks. But dropping a bomb, which you say you support, already assumes that Assad did it.
No. I support the actual method. Because there, even though it was this method in the madness, that if we did it properly, if we did go through Parliament, then it makes sense. I don't like the fact that we all woke up on Saturday morning to a 4-minute video of Theresa May saying why she did this and why she followed Donald Trump into battle.
So the question is this. In theory, if she had gone to Parliament and received parliamentary consent to do it, but the OPCW had not yet ascertained who carried out those chemical attacks, how would you still have supported the strikes?
That's a hard one, obviously. But I think there at least there is more democracy involved because it goes through Parliament.
The democracy here is important, but it's not what's the crux of this issue. The crux of this issue is ascertaining who did it.
Well, no. It's for us to take part, because if it doesn't go through, that's the way it works. At least all our MPs would have had a say. And I think even if the MPs had a say, it would have gone through anyway.
The point I'm making is this, that even if the British Parliament voted to bomb Assad for carrying out, quote-unquote, carrying out these attacks, without us being certain that Assad carried out these chemical attacks, such a vote by British MPs would be wrong. That's the point I'm making.
Oh, no, I can see the point of view you're coming from. I think it's just more, we had to do something. What could we have done? We could have waited.
Do something to who?
We could have waited years.
Do something to who?
Well, I think we would have had to go into Syria because I don't like the fact Theresa May called it humanitarian aid, but we've had to do something. The Syrian people are getting killed and badly hurt by their own leader. That's not right. That's, in any sense, you go, that's wrong, that should not be happening.
So are you talking about this particular chemical attack, or you're talking about the broader war that has been going on in that country for some years now?
I think it would have been the main war was the main starter, but that chemical attack, I think, pushed everyone over the edge. I think that, personally, seeing the footage, proper, just destroyed a lot of people because it was just too big.
The UK has been involved in Syria for some time now, the United States. So we always hear people say that about 500,000 people have been killed in Syria since that war began. Many of those people were killed by American bombs. The way there have been reports after reports, the UN, for example, reported last year that a great many of the people killed in Syria were killed either by Russian bombs or American bombs. And a lot of those that were killed were also killed by ISIS and other Islamist organizations that make up the quote-unquote opposition to Assad that the United Kingdom has been supporting over the years. So if you're talking about the broader war...
Unfortunately, we're going to go to a break.
Yes.
So please do join us after the break for another episode, another half. Thank you. Welcome back to The Vote with me, George Taylor, and I'm still joined by Johnbosco. Thank you very much for staying. So I think we last stayed off with Syria. I think that's one thing we're going to be, we could argue for days on.
Yes.
So might be best to agree to disagree, I'd say.
Well,
we're going to have a lot to discuss.
I'll make do with that.
Maybe in a future episode we'll carry
on. Yes.
But one thing I want to turn to is we've got local elections this year. We've got local elections in Brighton next year. We've seen the rise of momentum, rise in Labour. The Tories in polls still managed to stay with Labour. Lib Dems sort of stagnating at 7-8%. And the Greens in the local area...
Is that the national polls?
I'll go national on that side. Locally, we're much lower with Greens. I'd say still 5 for 3rd.
You're not much... The Lib Dems are not much lower. The Lib Dems don't exist here.
We don't have... we did lose our two councillors last election.
Yes.
But I think... We are fighting back, but taking the bias out of everything, I think we can win at least a seat, but I do see a Labour majority. I think that's something I think everyone's sort of expecting.
I don't think that we can take that for granted. I do expect, I'm a member of the Labour Party, full disclosure. Yes, and I do hope that the Labour Party wins an outright majority in Brighton and Hove Council, but I don't think that in politics you can take anything for granted at all. Mostly because everything in politics depends on what you do. Nothing is given. You can't just say, well, and this is the problem with much of political commentary. People just sit somewhere in their office or in their room and type up articles about how this is going to happen and this is going to happen and this is going to happen. But nothing is destined to happen. Everything that happens depends on what we do. The Lib Dems can win a few seats if they possibly, depending on what they do. And the Labour Party may not win an outright majority, depending on what we do. So I think that from the point of view of the Labour Party, that I hope would win an outright majority, it depends a lot on what we do.
Of course. So I think currently, obviously, it's a Labour-led city council. More and more than standing down, and Daniel Yates looks basically confirmed to take the reins. Do you think he could be a good leader?
Well, I don't know. I don't really know who Daniel... I've seen pictures of Daniel Yates, but I've never actually met the man, and I don't know who he is. I don't know his temperament. So I couldn't say anything at all about him. I would like to meet him someday. Okay. Yes, but I don't think that who the leader of the Labour group in the council is very important at all. I do think that... So, for example, let me give you what I believe to be the analysis that the Labour Party should pursue going into next year's local government elections here in Brighton. In 2015, when the Labour Party won 23 seats to the Conservatives' 20, it is important to remember that in that election, the Labour Party lost the national election, right? It was a local government election that happened at the same time with a national election. The Labour Party lost the national election, right?
Yeah.
And here in Brighton and Hove, we have three MPs. We have Peter Kyle in Hove, and we have Simon Kirby, I believe.
No, it's Lau Lloyd, Russell Moyle.
No, in 2015. In Kemptown. And then we have Caroline Lucas in Pavilion, right? In 2015, the Labour Party did not win two of those three seats, right? That was 2015 when the Labour Party won their slim majority.
Yeah.
Right. Fast forward to 2017, the Labour Party won Kemp Town with a healthy majority. Debatable what one defines as healthy. But of course, nobody can debate that we now have kept Hove with an incredible majority. Yes, and the latest elections we have seen happen here in Bretton & Hove City is East Bretton election, right? Yeah. And we saw that the Labour Party, even in a by-election that traditionally is supposed to have terribly low turnout, it still did have very low turnout, but it had high turnouts relative to other by-elections. And we grew our majority in that by-election. So the trends point to the Labour Party being able to harness a lot of new support. Now, I do think that what the Labour Party should do is do more of what Jeremy Corbyn has done, right? Not less of it. Because we see, regardless of how it's working anywhere else in the country, it's working here in Brighton. It's definitely working here in Brighton. Yeah. It's grown majorities in Hove. It's won us Kemp Town. And it's increased our majority, even in a safe seat like East Brighton. Right, and I think that what we should be doing is draft a manifesto that looks very much like that of Jeremy Corbyn. Try as much as possible to select candidates that look like Jeremy Corbyn. I mean,
I'm sure that could work either way.
We should not be selecting white male men, white male candidates, right? Of course, we should select some of them where we find good candidates, right?
Yeah.
But look like him ideologically, and I do think that that is the pathway to success for the Labour Party here in Brighton and Hove.
See, I see a few different things with Labour at the moment. So, obviously, being an outsider of the Labour Party, you see momentum, at least in Brighton, has been split in half. We've seen the resignation of Warren Morgan, and Warren Morgan, a known Blairite, a known centrist, and he's basically been forced out. Well, from what everyone outside to it, he's been forced out by momentum, because he doesn't follow the ways of Jeremy Corbyn. And with Nancy Platt's winning East Brighton, East Brighton was, of course, a safe Labour seat. It was always going to go Labour. I think it might have contributed a little bit the Jeremy Corbyn way, but to be honest, that was going to stay Labour no matter what. If it didn't go Labour at any point ever, it would have been the biggest shock.
Yeah, it's not a very good barometer, I have to admit, yes.
But somewhere like Hove is, well, yes, I know Jeremy Corbyn might have helped his majority a little bit.
No.
I think the majority of it is because Peter Kyle is a very good MP and he focuses more on the person because he's not a socialist. He's not that extreme socialist of momentum. He's a Blairite. And I think his way of being basically everywhere at once and being able to fight as much as he can. Of course, momentum came down to help him, but he grew that himself.
I feel very uncomfortable about banding around terms like Blairite. I do think that it can be insulting to some of the MPs and the councillors that we call Blairite, to call them Blairite, because it suggests that they don't have a mind of their own. But that said, I don't think that Peter Kyle grew his majority by being a good MP at all. He grew his majority because people came down from all over the country to campaign in Hove for him. He won a majority of around 2,000 in 2015. And just 2 years after that, when I suspect most people in Hove still don't know who he is, he grew it to 18,000. That is not by being a good MP. Nobody wins that by being a good MP. That is because people recognized that the direction the Labour Party is going is one that they intuitively agree with. It's one that seeks fairness, that seeks justice, one that abhors intuitively people slipping out on the streets.
See, I know people who voted Peter Kyle, not because they're Labour supporters, but because there is MP, and the way he's been performing in Parliament, being pro-EU, one of two MPs.
Do you know up to 1,000 of those people?
I couldn't say. I know them all by name.
Do you know up to 18,000 of those people?
But you know, there are people out there who are not going to just vote for him because, oh my God, Jeremy Corbyn is so great, I'm going to vote Peter Kyle. I think Peter Kyle needs to get much more applause and respect because he did it from being himself, from being a good MP. And from another party, I could say, look, he is brilliant, and I'm glad we have. As much as I would have liked to see Carrie Hyde's win, yes. Hove, he's a good person as well.
I do think that we who get involved intimately with politics often miss out on what's happening outside the realm of politics, if you like, that realm in which we are so conscious of politics. You're a member of the Lib Dems, which means you are to the right of the Labour Party.
Yeah.
Right. Now, if you have a Labour MP that, theoretically speaking, is to the right of, say, Jeremy Corbyn, you are more likely than not to like that person, yeah. Right? And it makes sense to see that that you would be biased in favor of a Labour Party MP that is to the right of Jeremy Corbyn, for example. But you have to keep in mind that the great majority of people out there are not paying this much attention to politics. But I've met so many people, that have told me Jeremy Corbyn was the first politician that I really cared about. And those people in Hove, those people that are saying for the first time, Jeremy Corbyn was the first politician I really cared about, did not go to the polls and vote for the Labour Party because of Peter Kyle. They went there to vote because they recognized something they really like in Jeremy Corbyn. And I do not believe that we should take that away from them.
Okay. We better go back to local council as we start to get near to the end of the show. So what are your predictions? Who do you think is going to become at least the leader of the council?
Yes.
And which parties do you think we're going to see?
Oh, I do think that the Labour Party is going to win an outright majority on the council, obviously.
Yep.
Well, of course, that's me blustering.
Okay.
But I do think that we should win an outright majority.
Okay, thank you very much for joining us. And thank you, John. See you next week.